This video is sponsored by Skillshare. Hey, Marcus, House with you here, and you're not going to believe how fast SpaceX has progressed with Starship development this week. We could be seeing another flight in just days at this point. We're going to talk about Starship interiors with Deep Space Courier's incredible animation. It is all go with Mars arrivals already occurring with NASA's Perseverance rover hot on their heels. Then we have some awesome news with the Artemis program, with SpaceX being selected to launch the first two elements with Falcon Heavy. This has been a great week.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
So even I've been surprised this week with the rapid progress of Starship serial number 10. Just remember here, Starship SN9 quite literally flew less than 2 weeks ago, ending in what we can only call a pretty rough landing. Well, fast forward to today, and we are looking at a potential flight of the next prototype SN10 this week, assuming successful tests prior. Now that could make it around 2 weeks between flights. Just think about the craziness of this for a minute. A 9-meter wide, 50-meter high vessel ready to fly just a few weeks after the last. This is what rapid prototyping means. RGV Aerial Photography shared this old image just recently. This was the build site only 2 years ago. Now it looks like this. Mauricio has had all of us covered watching continuously from the skies over the last few years, and is hugely appreciative of the help the community provide on his Patreon and YouTube to help him keep doing this. This is astronomical development speed. Is SN10 perfect? Of course not. Will it achieve everything it needs to in the next flight? More than likely not. But will SpaceX learn a lot to prepare for the prototype that comes after? You betcha. Normally, many months would pass, perhaps even years, before prototypes are ready to be built and tested in this way. Not at SpaceX. They build to push boundaries, and as Elon Musk has frequently stated, if things are not failing, you are not innovating enough. So many comments in my last video were all of a sudden super skeptical about Starship progress, almost appearing to give up on the whole idea simply because SN9's landing didn't seem to improve on SN8's. I think people are so hyped for success that they forget how incredibly complex and advanced all of this is. Now, SN8, which was the very first full-scale, high-altitude flight test, was near perfect in every way, with just that header tank pressure issue not allowing the adequate thrust for control for a successful touchdown. SN9 was almost identical, but again, a failed engine relight caused the prototype to overcorrect and hit the ground on its leeward side at around 200 kilometers per hour. Two prototypes, and both achieved incredible things never seen before in flight. I mean, this is crazy awesome. What we're witnessing here over the course of these last few months. Trust us all when we say we are looking at just the tip of what is to come, and in a year or two, this flip landing maneuver is going to be commonplace, perhaps even more common than watching Falcon 9 boosters land on drone ships, which seemed crazy only 5 years ago. I will concede, however, many comments I've been responding to this week asking why SpaceX doesn't land the prototype a little further away from the launch site. Now, I've got to say, this is a big question in my mind as well. Perhaps SpaceX doesn't have access to land nearby that could serve as a separate landing location. We know that there are restricted environmental factors that limit what can be done by SpaceX. Could that be the reason? It seems to me, and I guess many of us, that if there was a pad a kilometer or so away, a failed landing attempt would not cause quite that brown trousers effect that many of us felt as we watched debris fly in every direction here with SN9. It does seem riskier than it needs to be. I'm interested in your thoughts on that. Open up the floodgates there with a why don't they just thread. Let me know what you think. So yes, the progress this week has been pretty astounding. SN10's three Raptors have all been installed into the thrust pack. These include SN50, SN39, and another that we haven't yet identified. Surprisingly, SN39 was a Raptor engine that was removed from Starship serial number 8 a few months ago after it completed its first static fire. Presumably, it has been repaired and is now ready for flight once again. On Monday, SN10's testing campaign began, and starting with a cryogenic liquid nitrogen pressure test. As always, Boca Chica gal out there with NASA spaceflight recording the action there for us all. Thank you, Mary, as always. Early Monday morning, the road and beach were closed with the test beginning around midday. We saw a small line of frost at the base of the liquid oxygen tank, indicating that filling of the tanks had begun. The three engine chill vents then opened up one at a time. However, at around 1 p.m, both tanks were depressed and emptied. Vehicles then returned to the pad for around 20 minutes before leaving again, presumably to fix some small issue. Liquid nitrogen loading then began again, and this time we saw much more frost on the tanks. The whole of the oxygen tank and a small amount of the methane tank was covered in a layer of frost. Pressure was held in the vehicle for 2 hours or so, and the tanks were then detanked once again and the road was reopened, which all points towards it being a successful cryo test. Along with that, we spotted SpaceX doing a test fitting of the flight termination system, something that will be fixed in place the day of the flight attempt. This is normally a key indicator that SpaceX intends for some real action to take place that day. Work has also progressed at the orbital launch pad. The very large pad outside the bunker has been filled in with concrete. There are also vertical rebar sections here in the concrete, which suggests that some footings for some quite large equipment are going on top of the concrete pad. We'll be keeping an eye on all of that as the weeks progress. As Elon Musk tweeted at the start of the week, there are three key priorities for SpaceX down at the site. The orbital launch tower that can stack is on top, with of course producing enough Raptors for the booster itself. Along with that, reducing the dry mass of the entire vehicle is critical, which is why we are also seeing further effort going on with the thinner steel on the SN7.2 test tank. Now, last week, that test tank was intended to be pressed to failure. However, the 3mm test vessel appears to have provided positive indications, with its failure resulting in a relatively controlled leak from one of its weld points. That doesn't mean that testing is 100% complete or successful for SN7.2. We don't have any official word on that. Since the test though, scaffolding has since been erected around the tank to take a closer look at the failure point. We still expect SpaceX to repair that and then push the tank to even higher pressures before it fails, as we've seen with previous tanks. That is the point, of course, to push it to that destruction point. Always exciting to witness. Heading all the way over to news at the build site, BN1 or Booster Number 1's thrust dome was sleeved with a stack of two rings. We also saw SN17's forward dome being sleeved as well. SN11's tank section was moved into the high bay ahead of mating with the nose cone, and that nose cone was then moved from the low bay and was stacked on top of the tank section just days later. SN11, of course, is very similar to SN8, 9, and 10. We see the continued progress of the thermal protection system, and it's visible by the increased amount of tiles on various sections of the vehicles. The largest patch to date can be seen around the liquid methane tank on the windward side of this vessel. We hope to see this increasing even further in future Starship builds. So to sum up this week, of course, we have Brendan's diagram here, and this time with a couple of new changes to the overall style. Let us know if you like these changes, and of course, comment down below to see other improvements that you would like to see, and follow him there on Twitter if you want to stay up to date with all things Starship. And of course, if you're wanting to stay up to date with all things space news, please do consider subscribing here, commenting and liking these videos. That helps us a lot to make these videos even better. Thank you as always for coming back to keep up to date. Now, one of my most common questions outside the typical test dates and when hop updates are questions around the future interior of the Starship for crew-rated missions. Now, more recently, some of you may have spotted this video here by Deep Space Courier, which I must say is the most well-thought-out interior design for a Starship that I've seen so far. We'll dive into that more in a moment, but before that, a huge thanks to Skillshare for sponsoring this video. This incredible service provides you with an online learning community that will help you build on your creative skill set with a massive range of content offered. There are quite literally thousands of inspiring classes to help you start developing new skills or expanding on your existing base of knowledge. Now, with all of those skills, you may still be a little like me and fight it hard to be productive. Some days come easy, others not so much. I've just recently found Thomas Frank here on Skillshare talking about productivity, and wow, has this given me some great tips which are already helping me be more productive. he isn't just a productivity expert either, he is also an artist creating his own video and cinematic masterpieces while creating his own music on the side. If you want to find out how to set up your physical and digital space to work better for you instead of against you, you will find this material super useful. Skillshare, of course, is perfect for creatives and lifelong learners, and whether you're a beginner, a professional, or full-blown master, you'll find incredibly valuable learning opportunities here to increase your skills. It's also incredibly affordable at less than $10 a month with an annual subscription. Thanks again to Skillshare for their support of my channel here, and if you would like to help support me and would like to give it a try, the first 1,000 of my subscribers to follow the link will get a free trial of premium membership so you can explore your creativity. The link is in the description below. So yes, this interior design is the one I've liked more than any other that I've seen at this point. Keep in mind, of course, the reason that we see humans on board here in spacesuits is quite literally just because suited models are easier to work with. There is certainly no need to wear spacesuits inside the vessel. The main reason the humans are actually here is just to show how big this would all be inside. The viewing deck section of the vessel alone is a massive space. Obviously, these areas on long duration missions would be loaded with a lot more cargo and supplies in general, but imagine this being more of a tourist mission. A common room area underneath this would expand on that area with a number of utilities for social interaction and relaxation. The scale of the Starship at 9 meters wide is significant, and it would allow a heck of a lot of fun to be had in microgravity. Exercise is of course super critical as well, especially to any crew in space for an extended period of time. Who knows what amazing exercise contraptions there may be on the ship. Orientation doesn't matter in space, of course. Resistance bands and systems like we see on the International Space Station provide an excellent way to work out those muscles. Another key area in the Starship, of course, will be private spaces for each person to sleep and relax. And although these spaces seem quite tight, they would feel much more roomy with their own state-of-the-art entertainment system. Although it does look a little cramped, remember that in microgravity, you can utilize the full area, which I suspect would make it feel a little more roomy than it would here on Earth at 1G. Another constant area of query with Starship is how they would shield from radiation in the event of a solar storm. This idea is how we would expect the Starship to be laid out. Storage of water can be arranged in the walls around the radiation shelter, along with other cargo. Perhaps in the level underneath there is also another large section packed tight with cargo, which would also aid in that protection. Provided that the ship is oriented in the correct direction to allow the high energy particles to hit at the appropriate angle, the crew can isolate themselves in this area while the event passes. So yes, there is a lot more to explore in this video. The creators making this amazing work on the Deep Space Courier channel are two brothers aged only 19 and 22 who started learning Blender about a year ago with their combined new skills. With their love and excitement for space travel, it is obvious how passionate they are about the work that they are doing here on the channel. Really nice work, guys. Keep it up. A link to the full quality video, including the great audio, is in the description as well. Feel free to head over to support what they do and perhaps even throw a few future ideas at them. So yes, time seems to have passed by so quickly. It wasn't that long ago, July 2020 in fact, that we saw the launch of HOPE, the United Arab Emirates' first interplanetary voyage, followed shortly by China's first Mars mission, their Tianwen-1 spacecraft with its lander and rover, and of course NASA's Perseverance rover and the helicopter Ingenuity following as well. This week, after 200 days and 470 million kilometers, it was time for HOPE. HOPE thrusters burned for around 27 minutes, consuming half of its fuel reserves, slowing the spacecraft down so that it could be placed into orbit. This was truly a moment of celebration, not just for the United Arab Emirates, but humanity in general. With city buildings bathed in red light and a spectacular light show, we witnessed the live broadcast of the lead-up and the pivotal moment of HOPE's arrival with the announcement of successful orbital insertion and celebrations all around. The science that this craft is going to be collecting is going to be incredibly valuable and also freely available to the entire scientific community. This is truly a fantastic achievement with another nation, the fifth actually, making it to Mars. So yes, with HOPE prepared to undertake its primary mission in orbit, analyzing the Martian atmosphere and weather, there was another arrival to the neighborhood following close behind, China's Tianwen-1. Now, this spacecraft will orbit the Martian poles, conducting various science activities before commencing its second phase of the mission in about May this year. It's going to release a lander and rover destined for Utopia Planitia Crater, halfway between the planet's equator and the North Pole. It is here the scientists think there is a concealed deposit of water estimated to contain over 14,000 cubic kilometers of water, with the depth of the ice deposit ranging between 33 and 550 feet. Simply astonishing if true. Now next week, of course, we're going to see the arrival of the third Voyager to Mars, the Perseverance rover, and its much anticipated landing on the Martian surface. I cannot wait to see the outcome of this mission, in particular with some exciting sights and sounds expected to be captured during the probe's entry and descent. Of course, there is the Perseverance rover itself and the little helicopter Ingenuity to geek out over. Well, we have just under a week now to wait for this amazing science package to make its fiery arrival before being gently lowered to the surface to begin its mission and broaden humanity's understanding of this ancient planet. With all of the information gathered from these three arrivals to the Red Planet, it will eventually pave the way for even safer and targeted missions destined to Mars, with the most valuable cargo of all, life here from Earth. Now, while we are talking about Mars, you may have noticed this new globe here behind me. An incredibly generous patron had delivered this to me this week. No questions asked, no shout out wanted. Well, I'm shouting it out anyway. I've actually never seen these before in person, and I am just blown away by it. This thing is just crazy awesome, with the graphic layer in it all sourced from NASA satellite images. It just looks incredible, with the various layers of color showing super detail on the surface itself. This thing really is nuts. The thing just spins by itself whenever there's an ambient light via some combination of solar and magnet technology. And this isn't a plug for Mova Globes who makes it, it's just a thank you to the extremely generous individual who decided they were just going to purchase it and have it delivered to me for the set here. That is most amazing of you. Thank you very much. Now on Tuesday the 8th, more information dropped about the Lunar Gateway. SpaceX has actually been chosen to fly their Falcon Heavy rocket to deliver the first two elements. These two elements, the Power and Propulsion Element, or the PPE, and the Habitation and Logistics Outpost, or HALO for short, will need an extended fairing to be properly mounted onto the Falcon Heavy. Every stage of this vehicle is going to be amazing to see deploy, so hopefully there will be no delays, and this will be set to fly, hopefully, by May of 2024. This aligns with NASA's goals to land humans on the moon once again by the end of that year. Now, although it's likely that Artemis 3, the mission to land humans on the moon itself, will be delayed, it is clear that NASA wants to hold firm and continue on its path towards establishing, hopefully, a permanent presence on the moon. The Power and Propulsion Element will take care of a lot of different things for Gateway. As its name suggests, it's going to provide power through large solar panels that will extend from the tail end. These solar panels will generate the energy needed to run the Hall effect thrusters. These thrusters only need one type of propellant, making them a great fit for mass-dependent missions. These will run using xenon and should last around 15 years. This module will also include data relays, satellite dishes, and other communication and station-keeping elements on the vehicle, making it almost like a space tug for the space station itself. The other element, HALO, will be the living quarters and command center of the outpost. This will mostly be used to carry out the science and experiments, as well as house the entirety of the four-person crew living quarters. That module is very small and cramped, so I hope that the astronauts that get to live there are going to manage okay. So yes, what are your thoughts on the Artemis Gateway program? Will this station be a huge benefit for sending humans to the moon with the intention to stay, or were the single launch Apollo missions better? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Now, we are huge supporters of the transition to electric vehicles here on the channel, and our partner EV offers the ability to hire an electric vehicle in Australia. Perhaps you have wanted to take an extended test drive. You could be touring the country and want to drive around in a Tesla. If that sounds appealing to you, you can use the link in the description for a discount. Big thank you to the amazing patrons and YouTube members here. There is no way that we can continue creating content at this frequency and length without all of you. The support that you all here are providing allows us to increase the time that we can spend, and that is all thanks to that growing list we see right there. Thank you to each and every one of you. As support increases, that helps the entire team, so if you like what we're doing and you'd like to join our patrons here, head to patreon.com/marcushouse, or alternatively you can now join up as a YouTube member as well. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the linked roles on our Discord server. You can have your name listed right here like all of these other incredible people, and you can have earlier access to videos to watch before anyone else. Massive thank you especially to the production crew assisting greatly with video production, and of course to the quality control squad here helping me proof the material for these videos. If you're interested in these topics and you'd like to be a part of this, follow me on Twitter and please do get in touch. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video last week talking about the upcoming Inspiration 4 mission, the trouble with Sirius XM7, along with Starship updates. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTube has selected from my channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.